दिस वॉज सो दिस वर्स टॉक्स अबाउट यू नो हाउ डिफरेंट हाउ वी डेवलप एन अटैचमेंट टूवर्ड्स एनीथिंग इन दिस मटीरियल वर्ल्ड स्पेशली मटीरियल सेंस ऑब्जेक्ट्स. सो देर आर डिफरेंट इन दीज सीरीज ऑफ वर्सेज वील सी हाउ इट ऑल हैपन्स. सो फर्स्ट थिंग इज ध्यायतो विषयान पुंस. ध्यायतो मीन्स वी आर कंटेम्पलेटिंग इन आर माइंड वी आर थिंकिंग अबाउट अ सर्टन सेंस ऑब्जेक्ट एंड वी डू दैट. वेन वी डू दैट वी कीप थिंकिंग अबाउट इट कॉन्स्टेंटली देन इट्स वेरी नेचुरल दैट वॉट विल हैपन इज विल डेवलप एन अटैचमेंट टुवर्ड्स दैट थिंग. एंड देन फ्रॉम सच अटैचमेंट वॉट विल हैपन इज विल बी अ स्ट्रॉन्ग डिजायर दैट आई वॉन्ट दैट थिंग एनी हाउ एंड दैट इज कॉल्ड लस्ट. एंड देन वेन दैट लस्ट इज देयर द नेक्स्ट स्टेज हैपन्स एंड दैट इज इफ वी आर एबल टू सैटिस्फाई द लस्ट देन देर विल बी ग्रीड आई वॉन्ट मोर. बट इफ यू आर नॉट एबल टू सैटिस्फाई दैट लस्ट देन दैट विल लीड टू काम और क्रोध विच इज एंगर दैट वाई डिड आई नॉट गेट इट आई वॉन्टेड इट सो मच. सो दैट स्ट्रॉन्ग डिजायर इफ इट्स अनफुलफिल्ड इट लीड्स टू एंगर. So this is a whole series of verses we'll be looking at now, starting from this one of how it all happens. And then there is meditation, attachment, then lust, then anger. And then from anger, in the next verse, we'll see how our memory is completely bewildered and you know, we lose our intelligence and then we end up in a mess completely. So it all begins from here. So Srila Prabhupada would often say, you know, as Prabhuji was also mentioning in the last class, the three stages, like in psychology, they say thinking, feeling and willing. You know, it starts with thinking first, thinking about a certain object. So Vishayan means sense objects. Now, what are sense objects? We have five senses, our eyes, our nose, our ears and tongue and touch. And for all of these senses, there are sense objects. For example, the tongue will, the sense object for tongue is something to eat, you know, something very tasty, palatable. It is always hankering for something like that. Similarly, eyes want to see something very beautiful. You know, the hands want to touch something very beautiful. The ears want to listen to something that's nice. So like that, all our five senses are actually looking for some sense objects. And why are they looking for some sense objects? Can someone say? Why are we hankering for it? Anyone?
I think our mind is not very stable.
No, that we'll come to whether it's stable or not and why it's a later thing. But why are we looking for sense objects? Why are the senses looking for sense objects?
Gratification.
To perform.
Temptation.
What is that?
Desire or wish. To perform the wish.
To perform the wish. Okay. And why is that wish there in the first place?
Of desire,
temptation.
We think we are the enjoyer.
We think we are the enjoyers.
For enjoying, for gratifying our senses.
For gratifying our senses, that is what I was looking for. So when the sense comes in contact with the sense object, what happens is there is some kind of pleasure, right? So, and just to satisfy that so-called enjoyment of the senses, we are constantly looking for it. Now, this is how the whole system of, you know, devotional service or spirituality differs from materialism. Now, very often we might ask, you know, what is spirituality all about? I am spiritual, some people say, you know, and then we differentiate them from materialists. So how are they different is also in one way answered here. Now, a materialist is someone who will always look to satisfy his senses, which is, you know, he'll always look for opportunities for how I can satisfy my eyes, my nose, my tongue, my touch. I want the best of food. You know, I want the best of things to see. You know, so he's always constantly thinking of how I can satisfy my senses. And let's like, you know, in modern day, you'll have so many slogans, right? Live life to the fullest. Okay. Or Nike, just do it. So what Onida, you know, in the olden days, there would be this advertisement, our pride, neighbor's envy. So you will see all the things that are advertised in this world are actually telling you the same thing, how you can enjoy your senses to the fullest. And that is the ultimate goal of life. If someone can actually somehow or other, you know, get best of the food, best of the clothing, best of the shelter, you know, somehow good, give good inputs to our senses, the best of its kind, then one feels that, oh, my life is successful. So that is materialist. You know, he thinks that somehow if I can just provide nice things to the senses, live life to the fullest, then I am successful. And if he cannot get it, then he feels that I have failed in life, right? So this is completely opposite of how the spiritualist thinks. And we'll see why we are discussing these verses is because, yes, as one of you said, that we need to have control over our senses, our mind, and which we cannot do. So in spirituality, a yogi is someone who is actually trying to control his mind and senses. He does not let them loose. He does not let them, you know, go astray and then try and enjoy on their own. So it said yoga indriya samyamaha, which means one of the things that a yogi tries to achieve is to try and gather control over his mind and senses. He does not, for him, success is how good he is at controlling his mind and senses and not letting them loose. Just like in the last week's class, we were discussing this verse, you know, of how someone who's a transcendentalist, he is good at, you know, retracting his senses back. Can anyone remember the example that was given in the verse? It was compared to a certain animal. Anyone remembers?
I think it was tortoise.
Ah, very nice. Thank you. Yes, it was tortoise. So yatha sankarati tayam kurmo angani sarvasha sukurma, which means a tortoise. So a transcendental is someone who is expert at that. He knows when to use his senses and when to retract it. So which means whenever he sees that, you know, there is opportunity for sense gratification, he does not indulge in it. Rather, he pulls it back. So that is a spiritualist. You know, someone who's engaged in devotional service. He does not hanker for, you know, so-called sense enjoyment. Now, someone will ask, why would he do so? You know, we all want to be happy. And we think that to be happy means to gratify our senses to the fullest extent. Isn't that not what is advertised everywhere? Isn't that what we learned all our, you know, school and college and our family? Didn't everyone, you know, just tell that, yes, live life to the fullest? So you will see, you will compare that on the contrary. Like in the olden days, there would be yogis who would go and, you know, meditate in the Himalayas. And there is nothing practically, no sense object. You know, the yogi has no beautiful woman to look at. He has no, you know, modern smartphones. You know, he doesn't have the latest car. He doesn't have a bungalow there. You know, he doesn't have anything practically there. Materially is something that is, you know, we might be constantly looking for in life. He doesn't have anything at all. You know, he's just, you know, full in himself. You know, he's satisfied. And then it said, you know, Ramante Yogino Anante Satyanande Chidatmani. So which means that yogi, he's actually enjoying unlimited happiness. This verse says, Ramante Yogino Anante Satyanande Chidatmani, is enjoying unlimited bliss and happiness. Now we might wonder, how is that possible? You know, if he has no sense objects around him, the reason is that actually the enjoyment of the real happiness of bliss is not something outside. It's actually within. Sometimes we hold this session called happiness is an inside job. So in the material world, everyone thinks that happiness is outside, you know, in trying to somehow satisfy our senses and enjoy them. Whereas the truth is actually is happiness is inside. It's not in trying to satisfy our senses. Rather, it's in trying to control them and then raising our consciousness to a higher platform by which we can enjoy unending happiness like that. So happiness in this world is like, you know, in the desert, you will see sometimes an animal is there and he's very thirsty for water. And there is this mirage, you know, the reflection of the sun. And he thinks that, you know, there is water, you know, and he tries to go behind it. And he just goes ahead and ahead and ahead and ahead. And he's running behind that reflection, that mirage. But is the water actually there? It's not there. So ultimately what happens is that he, after running for a certain amount of time, you know, he dies because there is no water there in the desert. Similarly, the so-called happiness that we actually enjoy through the senses, we'll see in one of the later verses, how actually it gives to misery, and whatever it is there is also limited. You know, let's say you like a gulab jamun, you put it in your mouth and you will be very happy. But how many gulab jamuns can one eat? How many can you eat at one time? Anyone? How many can you eat? Yes. Anyone? How many gulab jamuns can we eat?
One of my uncle used to eat 30-35. they used to have competition in marriage. I mean, my mother's temple, so she told me about it. So I have not seen them, but I believe them, yes.
Okay.
It also depend upon the size, no?
Okay. But yes, after a certain limit, the point is that you will not feel, you will feel like, I'll not have gulab jamun for the next whole year.
Yeah.
Even if you eat 30, you manage to somehow eat 30, you know, you will feel that I'll not even see gulab jamun for the next whole year. Which means that our senses are, you know, only capable of a certain amount of enjoyment. They cannot go beyond that. Right? So therefore happiness, you know, in terms of sense enjoyment is also actually very limited. So if you look at the purport here, Srila Prabhupada gives some examples. So he says, you know, he's given example of Lord Shiva, of how great personalities also would get agitated. Just like you see here, you know, he gives the example of Lord Shiva. He was in meditation, but when Parvati agitated him for sense pleasure, he agreed to the proposal, and as a result, Kartikeya was born. So this happened because the demigods, you know, they knew that it's very difficult to fight with the demons. And they wanted that somehow Lord Shiva should give birth to a child. Because only if Lord Shiva gives birth to a child, you know, he'll be powerful enough to, you know, fight with the demons. Otherwise, it's very difficult. So that was a whole conspiracy there. You know, so they wanted, you know, a child born from Lord Shiva. So then Parvati was there, and then there was agitation. Even Lord Shiva was agitated. And as a result, Kartikeya was born, who was the commander-in-chief for all the demigods. So in like that, you will see different examples given in the scriptures. Even Lord Brahma, you know, he was himself, you know, agitated or, you know, allured by her, not allured exactly, but he got attracted to his own daughter, you know, Lord Brahma. So much so he was like madly running behind her. And then as a penance, he had to actually give up his own body later. So these examples are there in the scriptures, not to say that, oh, you know, even Lord Brahma, you know, fell down. Oh, even Lord Shiva fell down. It's not like that. It's just that from these examples, we understand that even if, you know, if such great personalities can actually be, you know, diverted or distracted by sense objects, then what to speak of us? How much more careful should we be when we are actually, you know, dealing with different things in life? How much more careful we should be. So there is the example of Haridas Thakur, you know, Prabhupada gives in the purport also. Haridas Thakur was a great devotee, and he would chant 3 lakh names a day, you know, every day, just like we chant, you know, for 45 minutes, an hour or 2 hours every day. You know, he would chant almost for the whole day. And once there, the Muslim ruler who was there, you know, he was not happy because Haridas Thakur was born in a Muslim family. So he was not happy that why is this person who is born in a Muslim family, you know, chanting this Hare Krishna. So then what he did was he sent, you know, a woman, a prostitute, late in the night at his place while he was chanting, you know, the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So this prostitute came and she proposed to him. She said, you know, while, you know, come on, you know, we can enjoy, you know, you're such a nice young person. And it was the dead of night, he was alone, and yet he said, yes, sure, I'll satisfy you, but let me complete my rounds. You know, I have taken a vow to complete this 192 rounds every day of Hare Krishna Mahamudra. After I complete, then surely. So she also sat there, and he sat and he continued chanting. And of course, the whole day passed by like that, because he would take so much time to complete so many rounds. And then she came the next day. And the same thing happened. He said, yes. And then he continued chanting, you know, Hare Krishna Mahamantra. And then the third day, again it happened. You know, he was chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra continuously. At the end of the third day, she was so much affected by the association of Haridas Thakur that her mind completely transformed and she became a great devotee. So this example Prabhupada gives here to contrast of how even great personality, someone who may be a controller in the material world, and on the other hand, someone who is a devotee who is completely engaged in chanting the holy names of the Lord and completely engaged in devotional service, even at the dead of night, if a woman comes, you know, to him to disturb him, he'll not be disturbed at all. you know, because he's completely engaged in Krishna consciousness. You know, he's deriving so much pleasure, you know, just by chanting of the holy names of the Lord, that he can understand that all this, you know, pleasure of, you know, sense enjoyment is so insignificant. Like we had seen in the previous class of the Prabhuji, was mentioning about Yamunacharya, you know. So there also he said that ever since I've actually started, you know, practicing Krishna consciousness, I'm enjoying so much newer and newer pleasure that whenever I think of sex life, I spit at the thought of it. So it becomes so insignificant, material sense pleasure, when one is actually getting that higher taste, you know, in Krishna consciousness. So then it becomes very easy, you know, to control the senses. So a practical point here would be that, yes, we know there are three stages, you know, there is thinking, there is feeling, and there is willing. So if we have to control the senses, then we should, you know, stop it at the stage of thinking itself. Because should the mind, you know, keep thinking, you know, about the sense object, just like we might think, oh, gulab jamun. Yesterday, I was just passing by that store and that gulab jamun looked so nicely drenched in that syrup and it was so nice and red. And it would be so wonderful if I could have that. You know, if you just keep meditating like that, the attachment will develop. And you, to the extent, then you start feeling it. It's in my mouth. It's so sweet. It's so nice. And then you will develop that such strong desire for it, the lust for it, that you will actually go out and then it will lead to action. So thinking, feeling, and then willing, it will lead to action ultimately. So the best idea is to stop it at the thinking stage itself. You know, we spoke of different examples and how a yogi actually goes and he is completely away from sense objects, you know, when he goes to the Himalayas. But what about us? You know, we are living in the city and we are completely surrounded by, you know, the media, the advertisements, and so many things which will actually, you know, try to entice us. So how do we take care of that? So we'll talk more about this in the next verse. Guruji, you'd like to add anything here?
Yeah, I mean, a few examples came to mind, but you can continue because both the verses are connected.
Yeah. Okay. Any questions or points? Otherwise, we'll go to the next verse. Okay. Verse number 63. Krodhad bhavati sammoha.
Krodhad bhavati sammoha.
Sammoha smriti vibramaha. So, would someone like to read the translation?
I'll go ahead. From anger, complete delusion arises, and from delusion, bewilderment of memory. When memory is bewildered, intelligence is lost, and when intelligence is lost, one feels down again into the material pool.
Yeah, one falls down again into the material pool. So now this is a continuation from the previous verse where it said, we contemplate, we develop attachment, there is lust, there is anger. And then from anger, now it's continuing. There is delusion, then bewilderment of memory. Intelligence is lost, and then one again falls down into the material pool. So you can see from where it started. It started by from just the contemplating of the senses. Now someone is completely, you know, fall into the trap. You know, his intelligence is lost. He does not know what he is doing. You know, he's completely lost sense of that I'm not the body, I'm spirit soul. And he's completely engaged in, you know, sense enjoyment. And there are many examples like that we can talk about. So there's the example of you know, Ajamil that comes in the Srimad Bhagavatam. He was born in a Brahmana family. He was a young boy. And so once he happened to go to the forest where he was going to collect some flowers for worship. So while he was passing through the forest, you know, he happened to see a young man and a woman, you know, embracing each other in the forest. And this is something that was completely unusual, you know, in the olden ages. Now it's a common sight, you know, you will see everywhere, whether it's on the streets or the television. But something like this was, you know, very, very unusual in the olden ages. So he happened to see this young man and the prostitute who were embracing each other. And his mind completely got agitated, you know, at that sight. He had not gone for anything wrong. He was actually going to collect some flowers, you know, from the forest for worship. But then when he happened to have this, you know, sight, you know, he came back and the same thing happened. You know, Dhyayato Vishayam Pumsha. He was contemplating on what happened. And because of the contemplation, he developed so much attachment that actually he called for that woman and he kept her as a maid servant. And later even married that woman, the same woman, you know, whom he saw in the forest. And then he actually had his own wife and children, but then he gave them all up. Just because he got so mad after that woman. So he made her, you know, his wife. You know, he had children. And then because he wanted to please her and provide for her, he started engaging in all kinds of sinful activities. Something that he had never thought of. You know, he was stealing. You know, he was lying. He was doing all kinds of, you know, sinful activities, which is completely forbidden. And although he was born in a nice Brahmana family and he was cultured, but yet, you know, everything was lost. And it started from that just one scene, you know, one thing that he saw in the forest. So you can see practically how it started from there and where it went. You know, completely losing one's intelligence, like it says in this verse. You know, memory is bewildered, intelligence is lost. What is right, what is wrong, everything is thrown out of the window. You know, so it can actually go to such levels of degradation. And that is what we see in the world also today outside. You know, doesn't it happen like that? We see so many practical, the newspaper is filled with, you know, articles and nice descriptions of it, and people, you know, even like to read it all so much. So like that, it happened. But then he was fortunate that the youngest son, you know, in his family, he had named him Narayan. And while he was on the verge of his death, you know, somehow Ajamil, he thought of his son and he called out his name, Narayan. You know, he shouted like that. And the Yamdutas had actually come to take his soul and take him to Yamraj, because he had committed so many sinful activities that, you know, he surely had to be punished. But because he chanted the name of Narayan just at that time, the order carriers of Lord Vishnu, the Vishnu Dutas, came there. And they stopped the Yamadutas. You know, they said, wait, you cannot take him. And they were like, what? You know, why can't we? We have never been stopped like that. You know, it's never happened that someone has stopped us. We are the Yamadutas and we are order carriers of Yamraj. And we thought he was the greatest personality, but we do not know that there is someone greater than him also. And the story goes on, I'll just cut it short. And he was saved, and then he could live and he could rectify his, you know, mistakes and then ultimately go back to the Lord. So that story also depicts the power of the holy name on how it can actually save one from the most degraded kind of situation and elevates one's consciousness so much so that he can actually go back to the Supreme Lord. We also see the example of Shobari Muni, you know, in the scriptures. He was a great yogi and he was meditating underwater. And while he was meditating underwater, you know, he thought he'll be underwater so there is no distraction, you know. Because yogis, they'll go to Himalayas or different places where there is no sense enjoyment, no objects of senses. And so there is, you know, no worry. So he was meditating inside water. But then, you know, he happened to see two fishes mating with each other. And when he had that sight, his mind got agitated. He felt, oh, I also need to enjoy. And he gave up his meditation and he came out of the water. And he then went to the king and he said that, I would like to marry your daughter. And actually, his position was very bad, in the sense that physically he was like a yogi. So he had matted hair and, you know, completely, he was not properly dressed and so on. And none of the daughters wanted to marry him. But then by yogic power, he actually transformed himself and he made himself look very young. And then he actually married all the 15 daughters of the king. And then he enjoyed with them, you know, for many, many years like that. But then after enjoying for so many years, you know, he felt, oh, how did I reach here? I was a yogi and I was practicing such great austerities, and I was enjoying such nice, you know, transcendental pleasure. I was on the way to achieving perfection in life. How did all of this happen? You know, he was thinking. And where did it start? It started from, you know, seeing those two fishes mating underwater. So again, the sight, you know, is something that can bewilder us. So we need to be very, very cautious, as we saw from the examples of how even great personalities could fall down. So how do we take care of this in the material world while we are not in the forest, we are not underwater. We are in the city where we are surrounded by such sights. So can anyone think? We can all think for maybe a minute, and then you all can maybe suggest some things.
Prabhuji, one thing, stay indoors only. Don't go anywhere. Lifetime lockdown. now I think we are used to also staying home.
Shobhri Muni also thought like that. He said, I'll go indoors, in water.
Because now really it's happening with me. If there is some work, urgent work where I have to go, I plan it, I go. I can't leave the home immediately. I gather 2-3 work and then I go once a week. And then I'm back.
No idea.
I gather all my work and then I go.
Okay.
So I don't
know. Any
interest? At home also you can watch movies and get the same feeling.
Yeah, you can watch movies and you get the same feeling.
Stop your internet.
No, but then again, big and small creatures are also around.
Don't pay internet bill. Automatically, it will be off.
No. I'm talking about the other insects and other small creatures at home.
Oh. Okay. Yes.
Like you saw fishes, you can see insects and lizards and other things at home.
I think you said it all starts with the thinking, right? The first, it starts with the thought. So how to control the thought, maybe in that stage, like, you know, normally when you're in anger, everything we say 1 to 10, right? Count 10, 9, 8, 7 or 1 to 10. So maybe when the thought is there, to try to stop the thought, maybe I'm just thinking, I could be wrong, is you just think about Krishna or I don't know, or you just chant at that very first stage so that you're able to control that thinking.
Okay, that's nice.
Yeah, may I add something here? You know, in our trainings also, I'm a corporate trainer. So, you know, I could relate with this because one of the things in one of the trainings we say is that your environment makes a huge difference, what you're surrounded with. So, you know, as Sujata said, that thinking. So I think your mind is very powerful. What you feed to your mind, that grows in your life. So like I'm just giving an example. So if I don't want to eat something, you know, rather than keeping in the house and then telling yourself not to eat it, at least in my environment, if I say, okay, I'll replace this, you know, so instead of, let's say, bread, I will eat, let's say, wheat. So I'll keep that. I will not keep bread. So I think similarly in your thought process, if you can focus on what you want to focus on, I think that becomes bigger in your life. So you have to replace that thought. I mean, even if that thought is coming, you have to replace it with something which you want to, you know, kind of grow in your life. So I'll just give you an example recently what happened, because, you know, we are talking about senses and focusing on Lord Krishna. So recently, you know, I was expecting some business from a client, and she called up yesterday and she said that, you know, we may not go ahead with, let's say, 2 batches of training. We'll just do 1. So I said, okay. Now, when I kept on the phone, honestly, I was for a moment slightly disappointed. Oh, shit, you know, I was expecting 2 batches and, you know, we'll, you know, I would have made this kind of money. And then immediately I told myself, you know, it's okay. I mean, you know, whatever is meant to come to my into my life will happen. And I should not get disturbed by this, you know. So let me try to apply the learning where we say equanimity of mind. Okay, so let's be okay with whatever is happening. And if you believe or trust in, you know, Krishna or whosoever you believe in, I think everything is happening for my good. So I think in that one moment when I actually tried to practice that, I felt a little better. So I think that's what I tried to apply. I don't know whether it's making any sense, but that's what I did.
No, it does make a lot of sense. And it's like the first step we take in our in shifting our way of thinking.
Yeah.
Because all along we've been thinking that, okay, if I can get, you know, material sense enjoyment, that is all in all, that is success in life. And the first step is to wait back and think, oh, wait, it's okay if I did
it's
not
okay.
get it.
It's okay, yeah. And I did feel and better, can, honestly, yeah.
And then we can, just like Mataji was suggesting, that we divert our things to something that's more, much better, you know, higher taste.
Yeah.
So first is to come, you know, come back and say, okay, it's okay, not get it. Oh, but there is something better also. You know, I can focus there also. Maybe try that also. That's wonderful. That's a wonderful realization. Thank you. There were so many wonderful points, you know, all of you all shared there. And yes, so you have heard of the three monkeys?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Don't see, don't hear. Talk, don't hear.
Don't see bad things. You know, don't hear bad. Don't speak anything bad. So that is like the negation process. You know, we can try and not see bad things, try and not hear bad things. We can keep ourselves in an environment where we are isolated and we are stuck in our rooms, just like in the present condition. But does that help actually? Because it said you are where your mind is, you know? So if your mind, if you're still, you know, isolated in such an environment, but if your mind is somewhere else, you know, meditating on something, else, then you will still end up, you know, doing that. So it's about the mind. So how do we actually control the mind and the senses? You know, it's given in the purport to this verse. You know, Srila Prabhupada explains, Srila Rupa Goswami explains from the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. He says, Prapanchi kathaya buddhya hari sambandhi vastuna mumukshvi parityago vairagyam falgu kathiyate. It means that we don't actually have to give up things, you know. Just like we thought that, okay, I'll not look at anything bad. I don't want to, you know, eat anything. Just like the impersonalist, he thinks that, you know, eating, I cannot eat anything because this eatable cannot be offered to the Lord because God is impersonal. So he negates it. He says, no, not this. Although the Buddhist will say, the desire is the cause of all suffering. You know, desiring something material is the cause of all problems. So I'll not desire. I'll become desireless. So that's the negation process. You're trying to withdraw yourself from sense objects, yeah, and there are processes and you might be able to do it to a certain extent, but that's not the foolproof way of actually trying to control your senses. Rather, what one should do is actually try to utilize the senses, you know, nicely in the service of the Lord, and that will purify the senses. Like in the last class, we had discussed how powerful the senses are. It's described that the senses are strong like serpents, you know, snakes. So if a snake comes and bites you, you are gone. You know, it's like if it's a poisonous snake, you know, it's like death. You know, you're meeting death if the snake bites you. So the senses are described like, you know, powerful snakes. So, but then the example is given, if the snake, if its poison teeth is taken out, then even a child will go and play with the snake. He'll not be worried because he knows that the poison teeth are taken out and there is no harm. Similarly, the senses, if they are engaged in the service of the Lord, then they will become purified. So much so that even if the sense of this is right in front of you, you will not be agitated. You will not be disturbed at all. Just like Haridas Thakur, we saw from, you know, the example. You know, he was completely engrossed in chanting the holy names of the Lord. And even though the sense of this was right in front of him, he was not at all disturbed. So the right way of controlling our mind and senses actually to utilize them in the service of the Lord. And we can see another example. You know, Hanuman, he was sent to Lanka. And while he was there, he was sent to Lanka to search for Mother Sita. So when he went there, you know, he was going through all the palaces of Ravana. And he was in searching for Mother Sita. He thought that, okay, I'll find her somewhere. He was checking for Mother Sita amongst all the different queens who were there in the palace, and it was night, and they were all, like, you know, intoxicated. They were not even properly dressed, and he was going through all of them and trying to, you know, look through, is this Mother Sita, is this Mother Sita? And he was just going through like that, and then a thought came to his mind. He said, is this what I'm doing right? is this correct? And he thought, I'm a brahmachari. I'm not supposed to be going through, you know, looking at so many women like this, and they're not even properly dressed. But then he thought, no, actually, you know, I'm actually engaged in this because this is the service to the Supreme Lord. And where else will I look for Mother Sita if not amongst women? So his mind was completely, you know, at the lotus feet of Lord Ram. So even though sense objects were present in front of him, he was not at all agitated. You know? Of course, this is an extreme example. We don't have to try and do like that and feel that, okay, I'm also so powerful like Hanuman. You know, I'll be able to control myself and my senses. But the point is that if one is engaged properly in the service of the Lord, you know, then his mind will not be agitated at all, even if the sense object is present right in front of him, like that. So the idea is to engage all our senses. You know, last week we were also discussing the example of Ambarish Maharaj, and he was a great king, and there was a whole series of verses, you know, describing his activities. Savai mana Krishna padaravindayo vasham shivaikunta gunanu varnane karo harer mandira marjana disho shrimat chakara chuta sat kathodaye mukundalinga le darshane drisho tadvrityas gatra sparsha anga sangamam granam ditatpada saroj sarabe shrimat tulasya rasanam tadarpate padau hare kshetra padanu sarpane shiro rishikesha padabhi vandane कामं च दास्य न तु काम काम्यया यतत्तम श्लोक जनाश्रयारतिः. So there it's described, Savai mana Krishna padaravindayo. Ambarish Maharaj, his mind was always thinking of the Supreme Lord. Vashamshi Vaikuntha gunanu varnane. You know, with his tongue, he was always glorifying the Lord and talking about, you know, the activities of the Lord. Vashamshi Vaikuntha gunanu varnane. Karo harer mandira marjanadishu. With his hands, he was constantly engaged in trying to, you know, serve and clean the temple. Then, you know, his legs he was using to actually, you know, travel to the temple. Then his tongue he was, you know, using it, you know, tasting the tulsi leaf that was offered to the Lord and eating, you know, prasadam that was offered to the Lord. So like that, you will see that all his mind and senses was constantly engaged in, you know, service of the Lord. And because of that, he was completely purified. And when the senses are purified, then that is actually the real way of controlling the senses. And not trying to artificially restrain them. Because no matter how hard you will try, like we said in the beginning, someone said at the beginning, that the senses are so strong that even if we try to control them, it is very difficult. You know, and we will not be able to control them. So the real control actually comes when we try and purify the senses by engaging the senses, Rishikesha, Rishikenas, Rishikena, Rishikesha, Sevanam. So by engaging the senses in the service of Rishikesha, the master of the senses, then the senses become purified. And then one is not agitated, even if he is sitting, you know, even if he's living in a city like Mumbai, you know, when there is all kinds of, you know, opportunities for sense enjoyment, he will not be agitated. Maybe we all could have been somewhere else on a Saturday morning, right? But then we chose to be here, right? So there is so much glamour and attraction and wanting to be happy materially. But there is something that is there that actually we understand, no, I'm getting a higher taste, you know, somewhere by chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, by listening to the message of the Bhagavad Gita. And that actually purifies our heart, our consciousness, our senses. And when that happens more and more, the senses become so purified that we will not want to engage in sense gratification. Then we lose that taste for a sense object, you know, just like we saw in the so many examples we discussed earlier. Yes. So, Any points, Ruj, you like to add, or any after that, then any questions?
Yeah, so just a quick you know, summary of, I wanted to kind of touch upon. We've heard so many examples, you know, but we should also start observing these in our own life, and that's where, you know, through the process of chanting, through the process of hearing, our heart is, you know, slowly and steadily getting purified, and we'll be able to identify when, you know, this entire series, the two verses, you know, when such a thing is happening to us. So if you look at this, Jayato Vishayan Pumsa Sangasteshu Pujayate Sangat Sanjayate Kamaha Kamat Krodho Pujayate. When we are contemplating on the object of senses, we want it, right? That is lust. And when that lust or want is unfulfilled, right, there is anger. I mean, I can immediately recollect.
I think volume is a little low, Prajee. Is it audible for others?
No, we can hear.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Is this better?
Yeah, better.
Did you all, could you all hear what I said earlier? Or?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I was saying, we should start relating to these verses, right? And I could immediately think of so many examples. I'll give you in an example which was, you know, many, many years ago. So basically, we used to fight. As children, we used to fight. Me and my sisters used to fight for, you know, watching the favorite channel on the television, and you fight for the remote control. I could see that, okay, I so much wanted to hear about a particular watch a particular show because I heard it from my friends, and then I'm not being able to, therefore I got angry and I'm starting to fight, right? So dhyayate vishayam sangashteshu jayate sangasam jayate kama kamat krodho bijayate. So anger develops, krodhat bhavati sammoha. Right, Proji, if you can scroll up a little, so we can see the word for word meaning. Right, krodhat bhavati sammoha. Sammoha is illusion, perfect illusion. Moha is illusion. Sammoha is perfect illusion. Right, you are so illusioned that you cannot see. Right, but at that point in time, you're not able to see. Okay, and I'm fighting with my sister, I'm yelling at my parents, etc. Could not see, right? Samoha smriti vibhrama. The memory is lost. We don't know, okay, I'm shouting at my parents. My parents are somebody who have, brought me up, who give me every single thing, right? And they're asking me to calm down and not fight with my sister, but I'm actually, rebelling against them or shouting at them only. So the memory is lost. And the memory is lost, we forget what the person has done for us, right? Smriti Brahmshad Buddhi Nasho. And then, after bewilderment of memory, intelligence is lost. And then we do something very, very stupid. Right? And then I would come up with plans to, take revenge. Right? Buddhi Nashad Pranashati. Fall down happens. And then that converts into action. Right? So that's how, step by step, we should start observing in our own lives. This is something which is happening to us practically on a daily basis. Right? Not that, it happened to Ajamil, it happened to someone else at a certain point in time. In our lives, this is happening practically on a daily basis to us, right? Somewhere or the other. But, the point is that we should start observing this. And, by the strength of our spirituality, by strength of chanting and, hearing Bhagavad Gita and having this piece of information, we should start observing and stop ourselves at a certain stage. So if you are at Krodha, like I think Sujata Mataji was mentioning how we should maybe count or divert our mind. So we should identify that, okay, I am going through this, almost like a person view. I am going through this, I need to stop here. And that's where, the more and more you hear Srila Prabhupada's books or Bhagavad Gita, or the more you chant, you will be able to develop this Shastra Chakshu, the bird's eye view of what is happening, right? Just to give you a quick example, right? If you want to cook halwa, right? When you're cooking halwa, you cannot be inside the kadai and cook halwa. Right? You have to be outside to cook halwa to be able to know what to put, what ingredients are needed, right? Similarly, if you want to make a good recipe if you want to plan your life, make it like a good serving and an offering to the Lord, you have to be outside, you have to actually have a bird's eye view. So these are the shlokas which, we really need to meditate on and see, how it's happening practically on a daily basis to us. And where can we stop? We need to start practicing. And slowly and steadily by practice, because these shlokas are meant to, apply in our lives. So slowly and steadily by practice, we can identify, stop ourselves. Like Prabhuji was saying, constantly thinking, stop the mind at the thinking stage. If we don't become conscious, right, slowly and steadily, we won't be able to do that. Yes, Prabhu. That's it.
Thank you. The practical understanding of how we need to apply actually all these verses in our life. Also, many good points, many of you all mentioned earlier. Yes, so the process of Krishna consciousness is there, how we control. And some of you all also mentioned we try and abstain. That is also right. It's not that we put ourselves only in such a situation that, it's so difficult to control our senses. We can't go to a nightclub and think, I'll control my senses here. I'll not be affected by my friends doing whatever they are doing. So out of sight is out of mind. So yes, we try and control our, as one of you said, our surroundings, you know, they affect us so much. So we try to put ourselves in the right atmosphere and right surroundings. And at the same time, practice of Krishna consciousness will help us, you know, protect us in that situation as well. Okay, any questions or comments? Else we'll go ahead to the next verse. So go to the next verse. Raga Desha Vimuktastu Vishayan Indriyasharan Atma Vashyar Videyatma
Atma Vashyar Videyatma
Prasadam Adigachati
Prasadam
Adigachate. Would anyone like to read this, the translation?
Yes. Raga Devasa Vimukhas Sayam Indriyas Charan Atma Vasya Vyar Vide Atma Prasadam Adi.
Thank you, Guruji, for reciting. Can someone read the translation?
I will read.
Yes, please.
But a person free from all attachments and aversions and able to control his senses through regulative principles of freedom can obtain the complete mercy of Lord.
Yeah. So again, this is continuation from the previous verses. Actually, all of these verses are like that. So it says, a person who is free from attachment and aversion, able to control his senses through regulative principles. So we need to be able to control our senses through some regulative principles of freedom. Now, it sounds contradictory, right? Regulative principles of freedom, which means we're trying to bring about a regulation and trying to restrain ourselves. But that is actually meant to give us freedom. We used to have a topic called freedom through restrictions. It sounds contradictory, but actually you are able to gain even larger control and freedom if you are able to restrain yourself. There was once, a senior devotee, is this Bhima Prabhu, a disciple of Srila Prabhupada. So he was mentioning, so he is an American, and his parents thought that, oh, you know, you have join this Hare Krishna, this ISKCON, there are so many restrictions in your life. You know, you cannot do this, you cannot do that, you do not enjoy life like we do. And, you know, we are so free, you know, we are free to do anything. And you know what his reply was to his parents? He said that, see, you know, you smoke, and if whenever you want to control yourself, or you desire that you don't want to smoke, you cannot do it. you are so much habituated to it that actually you cannot give it up. So who is free? Are you? So he said, are you free or am I free? I am free to choose to smoke or not to smoke, but you are so much controlled by that desire to smoke that
input motor.
So he was saying that you are so much controlled by that desire to smoke that even if you want to give it up, you cannot give it up. You know, you are controlled by it completely. So in other words, we feel that by engaging in sense enjoyment, we are so free. But actually, we're not free. We are becoming subservient to the senses. The senses say, I say, I want to see this. You know, tongue says, I want to, you know, taste this. And we are so much in control of the senses. The senses demand it and we have to somehow fulfill it. Otherwise, we go mad. You know, we become frustrated. So is that actually freedom? That's not freedom. The freedom is actually when you can choose whether you want to do that or not to do it. When you can restrain yourself. And that's why it's like that, regulative principles of freedom. So we'll read a little bit of the purport. It says, it is already explained that one may externally control the senses by some artificial process. But unless the senses are engaged in transcendental service of the Lord, there is every chance to fall. Okay. So, towards the end, there are some important points here. It says, therefore, to act or not to act is within his control because he acts only under the direction of Krishna. This consciousness is the causeless mercy of the Lord, which the devotee can achieve in spite of his being attached to the sensual platform. So this is like a very faith-giving statement, the last one. You know, it says that even if we are attached on the sensual platform and we might find ourselves helpless at times to control our senses, our mind, but this consciousness of trying to, you know, control them is actually the mercy of the Lord. So when we engage in devotional service, we are attracting the mercy of the Lord. And by his mercy, we'll be able to control the senses also. Like that. So, Kruji, any points to add further?
Yeah, I think just one statement to kind of continue what you just said. Yes, it's like, you know, Krishna likes strugglers. So people who struggle for, you know, him or Krishna. So, you know, not that, oh, you know, I'm perfect and, you know, I'm chanting so many rounds, etc. But even someone who's actually putting effort, right? So Krishna is, he looks and he appreciates. So this person is so much wanting to, you know, achieve me. And he's trying hard to give up smoking, like for example, he gave the example of smoking, right? Then Krishna's mercy flows, seeing that effort, seeing that you are so serious about it, right? So seeing your sincerity and seriousness, Krishna will give you the strength to immediately give it up, right? So that's how we attract the mercy of the Lord, like what you just mentioned. Just to elaborate,
Thank you so much, Suri. We'll go to the next verse. Any questions or comments? We're trying to cover as many verses today because we will have a very special activity next week, the next Saturday. So, and it's also these verses are in series. So we'll decide this one. Prasade sarva dukkhanam.
Prasade sarva dukkhanam.
Hanir ashyopa jayate.
Hanir
ashyopa jayate.
Prasanna chetaso hi asho.
Prasanna chetaso
hi asho. Buddhi paryavatishtate.
Buddhi paryavatishtate.
Can someone read the translation, please?
From one thus satisfied in Krishna consciousness, threefold miseries of material existence exist no longer. Such satisfied consciousness, one's intelligence is soon well established.
Yeah, so this verse says that someone who is such, you know, established in Krishna consciousness, for him the threefold miseries which will not be there, in other words, will not affect him. What are the threefold miseries? There is adhyatmik klesh, which means miseries due to our own body and mind. There is adhibhautik klesh, which means miseries due to other living entities. Maybe our people in the office, people in the family, maybe a mosquito which comes and bites. So that's like miseries due to other living entities. And then there is adhidevik klesh, which means miseries due to natural calamities. This verse is saying that actually someone who is established firmly in Krishna consciousness, then, you know, he'll not be affected so much by all of these miseries. It's not that it doesn't exist longer, like it says. It means that actually, even if these miseries are there, he'll not be affected. You know, he'll be equipoised. Just like Ambarish Maharaj was there, you know, he was equipoised. He was fasting and he had to break his fast, but Durvasa Muni happened to visit him. And so Durvasa Muni said that I'll come back after taking a bath. But then Ambarish Maharaj had to break his fast, and that the time of breaking his fast was passing by. So he was not sure what to do. You know, should I break my fast? If I break my fast, I would actually be eating before my guest, and that is not the etiquette. So he did not want to do that either. So he consulted and he took a little water, because water is like breaking fast also, and it's not breaking fast in one sense. So he did that. And then Durvasa Muni came to know that he had actually had a little water. And actually Durvasa Muni was a little envious towards him. So he said, how could you do that? You know, I'm your guest. And before me, how could you eat or drink anything? You know, he got very angry. So much so that he, you know, took a hair out of his, you know, head and he created a demon. He was a very powerful yogi. And he wanted to kill Ambarish Maharaj. But Ambarish Maharaj was completely unaffected. You know, he was completely dependent on the Lord, and he did not worry about, you know, at it at all. Of course, then in the story, it goes on that Sudarshan Chakra, you know, came after the demon, killed the demon, and it actually even started chasing Durvasa Muni. And Durvasa Muni was helplessly running all around, you know, afraid of Sudarshan Chakra. He went everywhere. He went to Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma. He went to Lord Vishnu also. And he was such a powerful yogi that he could travel anywhere. Even to Vaikuntha he could go. But he was not saved. And Lord Vishnu said that only Amrish Maharaj can actually now save you. You have to beg forgiveness from him. So Durvasa Muni had to do that. Someone who has his mind and senses completely engaged in Krishna consciousness, like we discussed in the verses, how Amrish Maharaj, although a king, he was completely engaged. You know, he'll not be affected by the threefold miseries. And his intelligence will be established, which means he, you know, he'll not lose his intelligence, like we saw, Dhyayato Visham, Pumshan, things like that. You know, it leads to completely destruction of the intelligence, that we cannot even understand what is right and wrong, and leads to a hellish path. We'll go to the next verse. Nasti buddhir ayuktasya.
Nasti buddhir ayuktasya.
Acha yuktasya bhavana.
Na yuktasya bhavana.
Na cha bhavayatah shantir.
Na cha bhavayatah shantir.
Ashantasya kutah sukham.
Ashantasya kutah sukham.
Can someone read the translation, please?
Yes. One who is not connected with the Supreme in Krishna consciousness can have neither transcendental intelligence nor a steady mind, without which there is no possibility of peace. And how can there be any happiness without peace?
Yeah. See, this is such an important verse. If just carefully look at what this verse says, it says, one who is not connected to the Supreme, which means if we have no relation with God or Krishna, can have neither transcendental intelligence nor a steady mind, without which there is no possibility of peace. That means your intelligence will not be very well established, and without that there is no possibility of peace. So everyone in the world is looking for peace, and then next it says, how can there be any happiness without peace? So there is no peace, there is no happiness. In other words, if you are not connected to the Supreme Lord in Krishna consciousness, then there is no question of peace or happiness. You know, it's very interesting what Prabhupada says in the purport. You know, he says here, we can look at this line. He says, one who is engaged without a relationship with Krishna is certainly always in distress and is without peace, however much he may make a show of peace and spiritual advancement in life. Krishna consciousness is a self-manifested peaceful condition which can be achieved only in relationship with Krishna. So which means that, you know, this, like, there are many peace formula verses in the Bhagavad Gita, and this is one of them, and which says that unless we have established a relationship with God, we will not be able to, you know, be peaceful or be happy. And we can make a show of it, you know, we can try and show that we are very happy in life, and we are, you know, our what is that, Instagram profiles can be filled of pictures where we show that, you know, we had so much fun and we are with our family and our friends and we went out for vacation and I'm just so happy even in this lockdown doing so many wonderful activities at home. My routine is such, and go on and on and on like that. So we can make a show of being very happy, but internally there'll always be that voidness, because if that voidness wasn't there, there was no need to show anyone that you're happy.
Yeah, Facebook and Instagram pictures and posts, right? Trying to showcase that how happy we are.
Yeah. So if you are actually happy, there was no need to show anyone that you are happy, right? So, but the happiness actually comes from getting the likes by showing that we are happy. So it's like a whole mess there in one sense. So, so we need to really start looking. Am I actually getting happiness, real happiness from, you know, these things? Or does it still lead to a certain void in me that I feel like there is still something lacking in my life? And like Prabhupada said here, that actually that lack or the voidness can actually only be, you know, filled by that relationship we establish with the Supreme Lord. And one may question, why is it so? Because by nature, the living entity is part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. And his real happiness comes from serving the Supreme Lord. And we can actually practically see it by, you know, engaging in Krishna conscious activities, by just like chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. You know, many of you all are joining every day in the morning. who would want to join, get up so early in the morning and, you know, practice chanting of Hare Krishna Mahamantra, or engaging in some practical service, or just hearing these, you know, wonderful words which probably we've never heard in our entire lifetime. No one taught us in school, no one taught us this in our family, and yet it's amazing that such wonderful instruction and wonderful knowledge is there in the Vedic scriptures. So just hearing this also sometimes can be so purifying and so fulfilling. So like that. Any questions or comments? It's already 12:30. Prabhuji, should we end here, or there are quite a few verses I think still remaining?
Seven more rather. Sure. So you want to announce about next week, and of course we can, you know, open the floor for questions. But yeah, if you want
to, would you like to?
Okay. So next week we are going to have a quiz. Sorry, just 1 second. Yeah. So next week we're going to have a quiz, and it's going to be very, very interesting. Not going to be a regular quiz. It's almost like a KBC show. And we have a very special guest who's going to host this entire thing. So his name is His Grace Anirudh Prabhu. He's one of my very senior godbrothers. And what we'll do probably right now is divide you all into some teams. And so that you can actually go and prepare. So this quiz is going to be on chapter 1 and 2. We're hoping to finish the second chapter today. But yeah, I think only 6 verses remaining. So we can divide you all into teams. And, you know, you all can go and reread. Not entirely, but I mean, it's not possible maybe in such short time. But at least, you know, scan the entire thing. And maybe divide even sections for, say for example, if we create a team of 5 people in one group. So 5 of y'all can divide, you know, maybe you do, you know, chapter 1, this portion, chapter 2, this portion, etc. like that. So, I mean, you cover the entire thing this week. And next Saturday, we can actually have the quiz. So, going to be really, really exciting. I mean, Prabhuji has, Anirudh Prabhu has hosted this even for some other groups. And it's literally like KBC. So, you know, be sure that it'll be really, really fun. And, you know, it'll be a good revision for all of us of both the chapters. That's the plan for next week. And maybe just after the questions, or should we divide it right away, divide the team right away and then do the questions? How do you think, Prabhuji?
Yes, Prabhuji, we can do. Any questions anyone has, we'll just, if there are no questions, we'll just finish with that only then. Any questions or comments on today's discussion? Okay. Okay, I think we'll divide, Prabhuji. We'll divide now.
Sure. So, yeah, I think I can see. Maybe let's go by the list which we see in the...
Prabhuji, I have one question.
Sure, go ahead.
Prabhuji, desire that we can control, wish, whatever I wish, that we can control, like not eating onions or garlic that, or anything else. Like, but what about the responsibility? How to deal with the responsibility?
Responsibility, I mean, you'll have to elaborate what it actually mean. I mean,
now I have as a responsibility means, and I cannot take out time. No, means cook.
You got muted.
Lots of works are there, like, so how to deal with that, manage.
You got muted in between. What I understood was there are a lot of responsibilities, meaning that it takes a lot of our time. So how to handle that? Is that your question?
Yes. Taking study, many things are there in front of like my classes, work, household work, like everything comes. No, so how to deal with? We can control the desire. Wo to hum kar rahe. Even work also we are doing. No issues, but.
Okay. So, yes, so our responsibilities are there and we continue fulfilling that. And as much as possible, we can spiritualize them. You know, if it is cooking, then we cook and we offer it to the Lord. And that, like you said, you don't eat onion, garlic. So you can offer it to the Lord and then that prasadam can be, you know, served to everyone. So in that sense, it's a responsibility which you have actually, you know, dovetailed in Krishna consciousness. And you are engaged in service in that sense. So if you cook, you know, with the consciousness that I'm, you know, cooking for the pleasure of the Lord and then offering it to the Lord and giving it to everyone as prasad, then that is actually devotion service. Similarly, if it's, you know, taking care of children or whatever it is. So the consciousness can be that, you know, I'm doing this. So we train children or, you know, do other activities, trying to spiritualize them, you know, in whatever way possible. So then that becomes devotional service. So, I mean, there are many things like that in the day. And as much as possible, then we should not also, whenever we have free time, utilize it to the fullest. Because there will be, you know, times when we don't even realize how it just gets spent. So we'll have to maybe take a account of, you know, how we are spending our time in different, you know, parts of the day and see how we can utilize it in Krishna consciousness.
Yeah, just to add there, Srila Prabhupada describes in Nectar of Instruction enthusiasm. So there is a shloka, utsaha, nishchaya, dhairya. There are six things which are favorable for devotional service. He defines utsaha or enthusiasm as endeavoring with intelligence. One must endeavor with intelligence, that is enthusiasm. So, I mean, every one of us faces a time crunch, faces, you know, how do we manage, you know, we have to deal with how do we manage our chanting, our sadhana, our deity worship, and at the same time, outside work, at the same time, some other responsibility. So that'll be a juggle always, right? So, what we need to do is plan, like Prabhuji was saying, create a schedule for yourself, right? Where you can, you know, fix a time for chanting, for example, or fix certain other, fix time for some other things as well. So obviously still it would be dynamic. It would be, you know, certain days, something, you know, unplanned comes at that point in time. So of course you have to kind of adjust things there, but at least you plan. At least Krishna sees that effort that, okay, oh, here is someone who's trying to plan her day so that she can actually take my name. And when you do that, Krishna will bless you with more and more time for him.
Okay, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Okay, there's a comment by Amit Prabhu. So whatever we do in the day, we do it with the feeling that we are doing to serve God. That's brilliant. All our responsibility is given to us by God, so we accept God's will and discharge our duties. Mm. Yeah, that's Krishna consciousness. If you're conscious that, you know, you're doing this as an offering to Krishna, then that's Krishna consciousness. Mm. Very nice.
Yeah. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so the sometimes people say we don't have time. We're so busy. We have so many responsibilities. How to take out time to serve God? So that was just just a thought that you don't have to take out special time to serve God. If we have this consciousness and the feeling that whatever we are doing, we're doing it to serve God. So everything will go well and we will not have stress and everything will go fine. So like explained by Prabhuji.
Yeah, just a small correction there. So yes, I mean, in principle, you know what you said. If you're conscious, so yes, that is Krishna consciousness. But at the same time, you know, it is the separate time that we take out for Krishna, right? Exclusive time for Krishna. If we take that out, that will help us stay Krishna conscious throughout the day. Like if you take out exclusive time for chanting, that itself will, it's like a vaccination, you know, Maya won't touch you. So throughout the day, then you can become Krishna, be Krishna conscious. Otherwise, there are so many agents of Maya to distract you that it will be just impossible.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhu. And good to see you.
Yeah.
So Prabhuji has been, he's just finished a session the entire night, I believe, and 4 o'clock in the morning. he's taking efforts to, you know, be part of the class. I'm really, really appreciate the effort from you.
No, I'm honored. I'm really privileged to be part of the group, and I really miss these sessions just because of the inability. I'm mostly sleeping at this time, or I just woke up, so that's why I could not join.
Okay, so good to, you know, have your association here. Thank you. So I think like some people are leaving. So Prabhuji, can we quickly first divide and then if there are more questions, we can continue. Okay, so how do we do this, Prabhu? Any suggestions? Or should we just go through the list? And I think there are 20 people here, 19 people here, including both of us. So yeah, I think in that case, 16 is a good count to divide by.
What we can do is, Prabhuji, I'll just call out names. And how many groups are we making?
We can make 4 groups. Four people in groups. Something like that.
Maybe I'll call out name and then I'll tell group number. They should just remember which group they belong to.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Krishna Prabhu, group 1. Amit Prabhu, group 2. Chinmay, group 3. Subramaniam Prabhu, group 4. Kavita Mataji, group 1. Meghna Mataji, group 2. Narani Mataji, group 3. Neeti Mataji, group 4. Pallavi, group 1. Priya Mataji, group 2. Priyanka Mataji, Group 3, Rinku Mataji, Group 4, Sujata Mataji, Group 1, Sutapa Mataji, Group 2, Yagya, Group 3.
And Harshita, Group 4.
Harshita Mataji, Group 4.
Yeah, yeah.
Do all of you remember your groups now? Now, how do they find out who is their group member?
Yeah, so that's a good question.
I can read the names, like I just noted down.
WhatsApp into the chat.
Let's put it in the chat.
Put it in the chat, yeah.
All those who are group one, can you put your names in the chat, saying group one and your name ahead in the chat? All who heard that they are part of group one, put your name, say group one hyphen your name. Yes.
Okay, that's good.
Just, yeah. Similarly, group 2, group 3, and group 4. Put your name in the chat.
Yeah, after group 1 completes, otherwise it will
come. Okay.
Okay, started. It will be easy if group 1 completes. Okay, I think group 1, 4 members are there.
Yeah.
Any more? Group 1?
Krishna Agarwal.
Yes.
Krishna Agarwal, you are in group 1?
Yeah.
Oh, there are 5 members of group 1. Okay. Meghna Mataji is group 2, sorry. Okay. So there are some exciting prizes also. It's not going to be just a simple quiz.
Wow.
You said it's going to be KBC. Right? But yeah, you won't be getting 1 crore. So that's not the prize. But yeah, there'll be some very interesting prizes for you.
Something better. Something better than that.
Yeah. Okay. So, Prabhu, I think if you can just take a quick snapshot, otherwise we will also lose this information.
Yagya, do you have it for everyone? If she wrote
yes.
It.
Yes.
Okay.
Great.
So, I'll name everyone, like in particular groups.
Yeah. So, maybe what we can do later is we can send out a message to, you know, those who are part of group one. You know, with all the participant names, and so you guys can actually coordinate on phone, you know, figure out who's, you know, deep diving into what section of chapter 1 and 2. Like that, you can divide and conquer. I mean, you guys can obviously go through both the chapters if you like, but yeah, somebody can focus more on certain sections so that, you know, your team gets to, you know, win the prize. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, go on to yeah.
No, I was just saying group 4 never started. Group 4, is anyone there?
Yes, myself, Rinku. Okay. I don't know to chat, so I'm just telling my name.
I'll put the name for you, Rinku.
Yes, Rinku Brahmo.
Oh.
Group 4.
Yes. Other members from group 4?
I'm Neeti Saharan, group 4.
Neeti
Saharan. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Have you come for the first time today?
I attended once, I think 3-4 weeks back. I'm very irregular, so I'm not very sure whether I would be there. But yes, I would be a part of it, and I'm liking it a lot.
Oh,
yeah. Nice. I've been introduced by Rinku Brahmoji.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Hi, Nitti. Even Didi was there today, but I think she has lost the connection.
Okay.
Jyoti Sharma is also there. He was there in the beginning. Prabhuji?
Yes,
Jyoti Sharma.
Yes, Jyoti Sharma.
So, Rinku Mataji, if there are other people, you can include them in the group 4.
Tony Sharma was also there. I think he has also lost connection.
Okay. So, I think what you can do is with Tony Sharma, Jyoti Sharma, Neeti Mataji and yourself, you four of you all can be part of group 4.
Okay.
Right? And you can lead and, you know, provide who will be doing what section so that, you know, you cover all the bases for chapter 1 and 2. And, you know, when we are actually doing the quiz, you can actually answer most of the questions in that case. So, yeah. So we will be sending this out on WhatsApp also. Please coordinate amongst yourselves so that you thoroughly go through both the chapters. Now that we've almost finished both the chapters, you thoroughly go through them. And, you know, we will see you in the quiz next week. Prabhuji.
So we have to decide the part or both the chapters?
Both the chapters will be there for the quiz. So there'll be questions from both the chapters. What I was saying was either you can do both the chapters together, you know, in the coming week, or if that is too much, somebody can focus. Say, for example, if you are the lead and Neeti Mataji, so you can give Neeti Mataji, okay, Neeti Mataji, why don't you do, you know, first 20 shlokas of the first chapter? So be thoroughly prepared with that. So any question from there, Neeti Mataji can address. Like that, you can divide. And it'll be easier for you to, you know, cover both the chapters.
Okay.
Yes,
thank you.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna.
We'll be picking up questions from the, you know, the translation and the purports both. So, yeah, I mean, just go through, scan it and, you know, then.
Is it open book quiz? For senior citizens, at least.
Well, if you cheat, we cannot help it.
You have phone a friend and all that. We'll call you, Prabhuji.
You will have a phone a friend. We'll have an audience poll. You will have, 50-50, all of those.
I need to have two phones then.
Yeah.
I'm not able to manage even one. Okay, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dhanvat. Prabhuji, group 2, Priya Mataji, myself and Sutapa Nandi, I don't know who that person is, but the fourth person is not showing up.
Okay.
Even group 3, we have 3 people.
Yeah.
And Priya Mataji has said that she won't be able to attend. Priya Mataji, she's writing in the chat.
Sure. Yeah, I read that.
So only 2 of us.
So what we can do is anyone whom you know has dropped out or some. Okay, let's first do this. There are 16 people on the call right now. So anybody who's belonging to group 2 and has not given you their name.
Vijay Madhav Prabhu, Preeti Pawar dropped out. So probably she can join group 2.
Correct. So yeah, what we'll do is we'll share on WhatsApp whatever groups you belong, and if there are people lacking there, you know, the others can always be connected. So Preeti Pawar can be part of the group 2. And I think Priya, you already have her number. Maybe you can or Meghna Mata, you can connect with her anyways, because we will also be sending this as an WhatsApp. Sorry.
Okay.
And yeah, we'll figure if there is one more person who can join our group, since there are only 2 people.
I think there's already Amit Prabhu, whom we are missing.
Amit Prabhu, yeah, he dropped off, I guess. So yeah, Amit Prabhu was part of group 2, correct.
Shailaja Mataji was the part.
Okay, let's do this. We'll send out. I think Yakya has noted everything. We are also trying
fill the gaps and send the list.
We'll kind of fill the gaps and share it.
I have a suggestion. Can't we have just two groups, one for first chapter and the other group for the second chapter?
We want you all to go through. Nice. So if there are people lacking on the day where we are hosting the quiz, we'll probably try and merge it. But I think
there are better chances of winning.
But the gifts are limited, so yeah, I mean that'll be a challenge. We just have four gifts.
Even one Mahamantra is enough for that gift.
Okay. Sure. So yeah, we'll figure. But at least whatever group you, right now, you know, you've been assigned. Just stick to that and try and divide and go through. It's an opportunity for us to go through, you know, chapters like overview quickly. Mm-hmm. All right. Anything else? Anybody has any other questions for Partha?
Okay.
All Nothing. Okay, Muzi, we end here?
Yes, we'll end here.
All right, thank you, everyone.
Yeah.